knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
Looking back at our chordate cladogram, we've covered the invertebrates in this clade, as well as the jawless vertebrates. So let's move forward and check out the jawed vertebrates of clade Nathostomata, which contains several classes. Members of the vertebrate class Chondrichthyes are often referred to as cartilaginous fish, which includes the sharks, skates, rays, and chimaeras. They are characterized by their skeleton made of cartilage instead of bone, as well as their 5 to 7 gill slits on the sides of their head. There are over 1,280 species of described cartilaginous fish, of which over 500 are shark species. They range in size from the diminutive spined pygmy shark and finless sleeper ray, both of which reach less than 1 foot in length as adults, all the way to massive creatures like the giant oceanic manta ray that can grow to over 9 meters or 30 feet in length, and female great white sharks that can grow to over 5.8 meters or 19 feet in length, although most adults rarely reach such sizes. Both of these species, however, are dwarfed by the massive whale shark that can grow to over 18 meters or 60 feet in length. In order to examine these animals, let's go over their unique characteristics, body systems, reproduction, and ecological roles. Then we will dispel some myths and summarize their classification. Sharks, such as the dogfish shark, are often considered to have a fusiform or spindle-shaped body with a heterocercal tail, in which the vertebral column turns upwards and extends into the dorsal lobe of the caudal fin. In addition, sharks generally also have paired pectoral and pelvic fins, with one or two median dorsal fins, along with a spiracle on either side of their head for respiration. Many species also have a median anal fin, and males have part of their pelvic fin modified to form a clasper, which is used in reproduction to move sperm into the female. Skates and rays, meanwhile, are considered to be dorsoventrally flattened, meaning their bodies are flattened from top to bottom, and their pectoral fins extend out to the sides. Many members of Chondrichthyes are renowned for their ability to sense and find prey in the vast oceanic expanse. Finding prey often begins with olfaction, or smell, by way of paired nostrils. Sharks are famously capable of detecting certain chemicals in extremely low concentrations. For example, the black-tip sharks have been reported to detect fish flesh diluted to 1 part per 10 billion parts of seawater. They also possess excellent hearing and process vibrations by way of an inner ear that consists of 3 large semicircular canals, which aid in balance and orientation. Sharks can also sense low-frequency vibrations by means of mechanoreceptors within their lateral line system. This system has modified receptor cells, known as neuromasts, located externally, which sense motion, vibration, and pressure in the water around them. But that's not all. In addition to excellent eyesight, even in dimly lit murky waters, sharks also have a tapetum lucidum, which reflects light in the eye and increases a shark's ability to see in the dark. But that's still not all their senses. Cartilaginous fish also possess ampullae of Lorenzini, which are a network of small jelly-filled pores that function as electroreceptors, allowing sharks to sense the electrical fields produced by living organisms. These are primarily present in the head, and some species, like the hammerhead sharks, have greatly increased the surface area of this region to allow for extremely keen electroreception. However, unlike other senses, these electroreceptors only work at close range in the final stages of an attack, but they can also help find prey that is hidden or buried in the sand, since they sense bioelectric fields. Finally, sharks also have taste and additional touch receptors located in and around their mouths. Most Chondrichthyes, except for electric rays and chimaeras, also have tough leathery skin that is covered in tooth-like placoid scales, also known as dermal denticles, which reduce turbulence in the water. Placoid scales are characteristic of the Chondrichthyes and have a unique morphology, with a spine in the center of the scale that is made of dentine, the same material found in human teeth, covered in a layer of enamel. Speaking of teeth, shark teeth are not cemented into the jaw like tetrapods and bony fishes. Their teeth can easily be shed, and new teeth grow in a continuous chain. Since they are continually lost throughout a shark's life, they can often be found on seashores, and fossilized shark teeth, including those from the extinct megalodon, are common finds in some parts of the world. Note that teeth vary widely by species and lifestyle. For example, compare the teeth of a fast-moving open ocean predator like the great white shark to a bottom-dwelling bat ray. Like all vertebrates, the chondrichthyes have skeletal, nervous, digestive, integumentary, endocrine, muscular, urinary, circulatory, respiratory, and reproductive systems. Their skeletal system is cartilaginous and serves as an attachment point for their powerful muscular system, which is composed of both red and white muscle fibers. The red muscles are used for sustained swimming and contain high levels of myoglobin, which allows for efficient oxygen storage. White muscles are used for rapid burst swimming and contain fewer blood vessels and less myoglobin. Their digestive system begins with the mouth, which opens into a large pharynx that empties into a short, wide esophagus, which in turn empties into the large, J-shaped stomach, which passes into a short, straight intestine. Here as well, the pancreas and liver attach and discharge their contents. The liver of sharks is especially interesting because it is large and complex, making up a significant portion of the total body mass. It produces bile, aids in detoxification, and also contains large amounts of oil that is less dense than seawater, thus helping the shark remain buoyant since cartilaginous fish lack swim bladders. From the intestine, food and excreted materials pass the spiral valve that slows the passage of food and attaches to a short rectum and rectal gland that secretes sodium chloride and helps the paired kidneys of the urinary system regulate the salt concentration of the blood. The respiratory system of the cartilaginous fish often begins with a spiracle which varies in size and can be tiny and circular, like in the nurse shark, or extended and slit-like, as in the wobbegongs. Water is passed from the spiracle over the gills, where oxygen is extracted by way of thousands of leaf-like lamellae, or flaps, which contain blood vessels, and carbon dioxide is expelled from the external gill slits. However, many large fast-moving species, like thresher sharks and mackerel sharks, entirely lack spiracles. The circulatory system includes a two-chambered heart comprised of an atrium and ventricle. Blood is oxygenated at the gills and then flows through the rest of the shark's body. The nervous system is comprised of a three-part brain, forebrain, midbrain, and hindbrain, that connects to the spinal cord and all receptors such as the eyes, olfactory system, lateral line system, and ampullae of Lorenzini. Cartilaginous fish have a remarkably mammal-like immune system that is very similar to all other jawed vertebrates in that it is adaptive and can combat many different forms of infection. In addition, their hormonal or endocrine system is responsible for controlling various physiological processes and includes the pituitary and thyroid glands, among others. The integumentary system includes the skin, placoid scales, receptor cells, and mucus-secreting cells that provide additional protection against parasites and microbes, while also reducing the drag during swimming. The reproductive system involves separate sexes with males possessing testes and claspers for sperm transfer, and females possessing ovaries and oviducts. Fertilization is internal, with the male claspers inserted into the female cloaca and releasing sperm. Unlike the bony fish and amphibians, cartilaginous fish do not spawn or externally fertilize eggs. Courtship varies by species, but males generally perform rituals and release pheromones in order to attract a mate. After fertilization, some sharks and all skates lay fertilized eggs, meaning they are oviparous species, and skates are well known for depositing their eggs in a distinctive keratinized capsule known as a mermaid's purse. Within the egg, the developing embryo is nourished for a long time, often 6 to 9 months or even up to 2 years, depending on the species. Rays, meanwhile, and sharks like the great white, are viviparous, or ovoviviparous, meaning females retain the developing young within the uterus and give birth to fully formed young. Some species nourish the developing young through a yolk sac placenta or through uterine milk produced by the mother. In addition, the developing young of some species, such as the sand tiger sharks, participate in intrauterine cannibalization, where the siblings consume each other while in the uterus. As a group, cartilaginous fish fill a range of ecological niches, or roles, though they are primarily noted as important upper-level carnivores that keep the populations of other animals in check, thus maintaining ecological balance. However, different species play very different roles. For example, many skates and rays are benthic predators that are preyed upon by larger animals, while whale sharks consume large amounts of plankton and help regulate their populations. Cartilaginous fish are essential to our oceans. For example, when sharks are removed from reefs, it can have a significant impact on the entire ecosystem. Without sharks, smaller predators such as snappers and groupers can become overpopulated, leading to a decline in the populations of herbivorous fish. This in turn can lead to higher algae populations, which can smother coral and other reef organisms. Meanwhile, in areas where shark populations have been restored, such as seagrass ecosystems, the populations of fish and other marine animals also increase, contributing to a healthier and more diverse ecosystem. Next, let's dispel a few myths. First, there is the pervasive belief that sharks are dangerous manhunters. Though sharks have been greatly maligned by humanity, most species are naturally timid and cautious. Though shark attacks do happen, most of them are committed by only a handful of species out of the over 500 species of sharks. For example, in 2022, there were only 57 confirmed unprovoked shark attacks globally. In the United States, a person's chance of getting attacked by a shark is 1 in 11.5 million, and a person's chance of getting killed by a shark is less than 1 in 264.1 million. However, there do seem to be many videos of sharks attacking diving cages, bumping boats, chewing on metal, and even attacking propellers. If sharks are so docile and attacks are so rare, you may wonder what's going on here. The answer has to do with both shark intelligence and their sensory organs. Recall that sharks have electroreceptor organs known as ampullae of Lorenzini that sense electric pulses, such as those produced by all living animals and also all electronic equipment. This means that metal bars, boats, and motors are potentially very confusing to sharks. Since sharks are intelligent and curious, they generally investigate further by using their touch and taste receptors, which are located within their mouths. In addition, most footage of sharks biting metal bars are the result of chumming, where sharks are purposely baited to an area. Moving on to some other myths, sharks are not invincible predators at the top of the food chain. Remember that most cartilaginous species are small and timid, but even large species like great whites are occasionally preyed upon by orcas, and humans are a major cause of the global decline of shark species due to bycatch and purposeful capture for shark fin soup. Next, sharks are not immune to cancer. This is a myth going back to the 1970s, which found that cartilage could stop new blood vessels from growing into tissues, but sharks can and do get cancer, and they have been discovered with tumors. Lastly, most cartilaginous species do not die if they stop swimming, but a few do. Most species are capable of buccal pumping, where muscles pull water over the gills. You can see this in any shark resting on the ocean floor. Most shark species are also capable of ram ventilation, which is less energy intensive and allows for passive breathing while swimming. Most species can do both ram ventilation while swimming and buccal pumping while resting, but there are a few confirmed species, like the thresher shark, mako shark, and great white, that are obligate ram breathers, meaning they are incapable of buccal pumping and must always swim to breathe. Thankfully, swimming for such fast-moving species is actually less energy-intensive than remaining still. Finally, let's quickly look at classification. The class Chondrichthyes is split between two subclasses. Elasmobranchii includes the sharks, skates, and rays, and thus the vast majority of species. Holocephali includes only the chimaeras. Elasmobranchii is further broken into three superorders: Galeomorphii, which includes the Galean sharks such as the bullheads, carpet sharks, and mackerel sharks; Squalomorphii, or squalene sharks such as the cow sharks, saw sharks, and dogfish; and Batoidea, which includes the stingrays, manta rays, skates, and electric rays. Let's move forward and get a better sense of this diversity next.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.